Hi, Paul Thompson here from Spitfire Audio. One of the things we're consistently asked for is feedback on compositions, so that's what this video is all about. I've been talking to the four runners-up of the 2022 Bridgerton Scoring Competition on ideas that they might implement in their next score. Winning the competition is obviously a fantastic achievement, but for the thousands of people that entered, it's a great opportunity to test your skills and to explore developing new skills in scoring to picture. I shared my thoughts with the runners-up as if they were composer assistants working for me on cues on a bigger project. And if you did enter the competition, I'd encourage you to finish this video, note down any of the thoughts that we discussed that resonate with you, and then maybe take a step back, look at your composition entry with fresh ears, and see if any of these ideas might have helped you to improve your entry and could improve you for next time as well. So welcome to you all. It's great to have you here today. I think if we start with a quick intro from all of you, tell us who you are, where you're from, and how long you've been composing. So if we go in the order that I'm going to do feedback, that would be great. So Taylor, if we could start with you.
Sure. I'm Taylor Ash. I am from the great city of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. And I've been composing for about 15 years, but really not in the film world until the past couple of years. So.
Okay, great. And Greg?
Hi there. My name's Greg. I'm in Guildford, around about an hour outside of London. I've been doing music all my life, but composing specifically for about 3 years.
Brilliant. Okay. Riwal?
Hi, I'm Riwal. I'm in France right now, and I've been composing for about 6-7 years.
Brilliant. And Chris?
My name is Chris Shiflett. I live in Louisiana in the States, and I've mainly been into songwriting for bands, and as of the last 4 years or so, I've been composing for media and things like that.
Fantastic. Okay, great. Right, so I think the way that we're going to run this is we'll start with Taylor, as I said. Mm-hmm. So if you could give us a quick outline of how you approach the score first, then we'll have a look at the video, and then I'll give you some of my feedback as well. So how did you approach writing the music for this?
So I watched the scene many, many times. And when I put it into my Logic is the primary DAW I use, and I just kind of divided it up into specific sections and specific moments that I knew I wanted to either hit, like the Duke of Hastings. I knew I wanted that to be a moment, and kind of I knew I wanted also to have a theme that ran throughout the whole thing and then shifting to fit those specific moments that I had laid out. I also had specific instruments in mind for specific characters or when they were talking about specific characters. For instance, like the flute represents Daphne. It's kind of sparkly like a diamond. That's what I thought of. And so, yeah, those were my thoughts as I did the whole thing.
Okay, great. Well, let's have a look at your video now, and then afterwards I'll give you a few ideas that I had when watching.
You are getting what you always wanted. You are marrying for love.
One may say modesty is a virtue, yet this author is hardly a virtuous woman. It is therefore my great pleasure to announce the news others questioned, but I never doubted.
It will be the grandest wedding of the year. Tulips are enough to fill the great room and the finest silks. Only the best for Miss Bridgerton and my nephew. The latest whistledown. How does she report my triumph?
The diamond of the season has made her match. Officially betrothed to the Duke of Hastings.
Has something happened?
The bride undoubtedly is giddy with anticipation over the impending nuptials.
Well, I shall need fittings for the dress. And my trousseau. I'm forgetting something, surely, Rose.
I shall take care of everything, miss. Just think. Should be the Duchess by Saturday.
An event that will apparently take place sooner rather than later. Of course, there are only two reasons to procure a special license and race to the altar. True love, or concealing a scandal.
How
does it feel, sister, to be in love?
Imagine leaping off a cliff and shattering on the ground. A fair analogy?
I'm afraid I cannot find the words, dear Hyacinth. Though, Eloise, I do believe you will know what love feels like soon enough next season.
So the key technical thing, which I thought would be a really great thing for you to focus on from your track, would be the shaping of each part. Now, I've always approached, every time I'm writing in an orchestration onto the door, I try to make each part like as if it was being played by the actual player in terms of the way that I'm shaping often the dynamics, but also the expression to exaggerate that. And the thing that I've really noticed over the years is that when you don't have, when it's just a mock-up, you don't have any live players on it, you really have to exaggerate that to make it come through. Because everything seems, especially in, you know, in a piece for media where we often compressing the track and then it gets, you know, lowered, then you've got the you know, the kind of voices on top of that and all that kind of stuff.
Right.
By the time you actually hear it back, everything has been squashed down. So for me, an absolute key thing is to really exaggerate all of the moves, all of the dynamics, almost to a point where you think you've overdone it.
Overdone
if you think you've overdone it, it's probably right, is my kind of my general idea. So that would be my first thing. Now, in terms of the my three kind of creative comments on your track, so when we cut back to the Queen, when when we've had the letter, I would hold the restart until that cut.
Got it.
So you restart a tiny bit earlier, and I think this is something I'm going to pick up with all of you actually on. There's a real discussion about where we whether we hit cuts, whether we delay, whether we advance, and all of that kind of stuff. Whether it, you know, you don't want to be too Mickey Mousey, but I think when you have the way that this is, this program is so beautifully shot and staged, there we tend to get in these kind of sequences where there's a lot of information to get across, the direction will tend to be more exaggerated.
Right.
So the cuts are quite dramatic, you know. I'll pick it up as we go through. But I would say that here, my instinct would be to hit more of these cuts, especially when it's a cut that is either a very dramatic moment or a very obvious time, you know, time movement or spatial movement if you're going from one location to another, because they're done in quite a you know, enthusiastic way. There's nothing being covered up here. It's really glorying in the kind of abrupt transformation from one thing to another. So I would just follow that. I think as long as you're writing, as long as you're not kind of writing funny music, then you just, you're helping the kind of slightly overwrought drama, which is the part of the joy of the show. So that would be my first thing. Now, when we go into the boudoir, I think, and we're looking at the kind of, you know, they're talking about the bridal, you know, clothing and all that kind of stuff. I think that that the start that you have here, there are too many things that are starting at exactly the same moment as the dialogue.
I totally agree. I messed with that moment so many times that I just never felt like it was right. But okay.
It's very tricky, this bit, and I'll be picking it up with a couple of you as well. But the key here is you've got to come in, and the dialogue starts right at the beginning of the scene. So you've got to find a way to avoid the dialogue, and it can sometimes be in the density of the orchestration. You have to thin it right out. Sometimes it's the timbre of the instruments or the pitch that you're picking, but you've got to find a way of carving out space for the audience to hear that dialogue. Otherwise, it becomes a bit confusing. My final thought was: I love the swell that happens after the cut to the carriage. However, I would hit the cut. I would swell onto the cut. I think it's fine to lead into that transition because, you know, it's a big transition. But I think at the moment you kind of lead across the transition and then you kind of impact slightly after the cut. And I would just go for, you know, maximum effect and really just kind of, you know, just really celebrate that huge cut. Mm-hmm. You've got all the sound effects as well, the horse's mm-hmm. hooves and all that kind of mm-hmm. stuff. So you know there's yeah. going to be an abrupt change in the sound effects track. So right. I would celebrate that and okay. go for it with the music as well.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
So those are my tips.
Thank you so much.
For how I would suggest a few ideas for changes.
Yeah. They're great. Thank okay. you.
Brilliant. Okay, thanks, Taylor. Yeah. Right, Greg, let's move on to you next. So tell us how you approached scoring the picture.
Yes, so after watching it through a couple of times, I had an instinctive feeling for the scene where the bride is getting ready. I heard something, because the camera movement is very fast, so I thought something, the musically should be quite big there, even though you mentioned about the dialogue. And I instantly sketched that bit out on piano, and then it was more of a case of working out how to lead up to it. And I think I knew it should be, there should be a steady rhythm across each bit, and as a way to sort of tie each scene. And especially if I have a rhythm at the end and a rhythm at the beginning, I sort of tie them together with a bit of a melodic bit in the middle. And then it was a case of just filling it out.
Okay, great. Right, well, let's have a look at your version, and then we'll dive into the thoughts straight after.
You are getting what you always wanted. You are marrying for love.
One may say modesty is a virtue, yet this author is hardly a virtuous woman. It is therefore my great pleasure to announce the news others questioned, but I never doubted.
It will be the grandest wedding of the year. Tulips are enough to fill the great room and the finest silks. Only the best. For Miss Bridgerton and my nephew. The latest whistledown. How does she report my triumph?
The diamond of the season has made her match. Officially betrothed to the Duke of Hastings.
Has something happened?
Bride undoubtedly is giddy with anticipation over the impending nuptials.
Well, I shall need fittings for the dress. And my trousseau. And, oh, I'm forgetting something, surely, Rose.
I shall take care of everything, miss. Just think, she'll be the Duchess by Saturday.
An event that will apparently take place sooner rather than later. Of course, there are only two reasons to procure a special license and race to the altar. True love, or concealing a scandal.
Does it feel, sister, to be in love?
Imagine leaping off a cliff and shattering on the ground. A fair analogy?
I'm afraid I cannot find the words, dear Hyacinth. Though, Eloise, I do believe you will know what love feels like soon enough next season.
So my technical tip for you is it's two things. I'm going to talk about dynamics, as we just did with Taylor as well, but also microphone choice. Now, I know this is not always possible on every sample library. Some libraries have options for mics and some don't. So this is not always something that you can control. But in addition to the kind of, you know, exploring the outer edges of the dynamics when you're sketching each part in, I would try to, I often use the outriggers on my, or the widest kind of sound, whether, you know, it's a stage, you know, a kind of a Blumlein type stage pair or something like that. Whatever you have that can help you get a bit of extra width into the sound and push some of the instruments out to the sides really, really helps. Now, it's not, obviously in cinema, you've got the center speaker, which most of the dialogue comes out of traditionally. And so sticking, you know, trying to avoid that center speaker and trying to get most of your music happening in a nice wide stereo image is always a good tip, because it helps you, you know, it helps you not get your music turned down by the dubbing mixer. Now, this is the theory kind of is the same for TV. So anything you can use that can widen the stage slightly and help you to maybe, you know, explore the panning, even if you've got stuff that's recorded in situ, I might, you know, if I've got a part from, you know, a woodwind solo or something, and I know that, it, you know, that the player is sitting kind of pretty much in front of the deck of tree, I will try and artificially move them slightly to the side so that I'm clearing a little bit of space in the middle there for the dialogue. It's all, a lot of these things are, that I'm going to talk about are all about avoiding stepping on the dialogue, because when you step on the dialogue, you're going to lose. It's a battle that you can't win. The director will always choose the dialogue. The dubbing mixer will always choose the dialogue. So the more we can stay out of the way of that, the more effectiveness we can have in kind of communicating the stuff that we want to communicate, the emotional subtext of the scene and all that kind of stuff. So that would be my technical tip. Now, the three kind of creative thoughts that I had, when we have the arrival of the pamphlet, I've said an octave down. I would move it in some way out of the range of the dialogue. Now, I was kind of slightly hesitant to say this because I don't think you're really stepping on it too much here, but I think that because you've got a kind of interesting rhythmic figure going, it becomes, you know, it then starts to impede a little bit. And so I was wondering, is there something that you can do? It might be dropping it back a dynamic, but, you know, it might be drop down an octave, you know, maybe kind of lower in the cello range or something like that. Yeah. Again, it's to stay out of the way of the dialogue. So you can keep the motor going. You can keep your, you know, your rhythmic ideas going. You don't have to stop everything, but it does help you to keep out of the way of clashing there. I think that, interestingly, you do this later when you have the stairs, when they're coming down the stairs, you do it really well there. And I think that just a kind of similar approach, maybe it's just thinning it out a little bit or something like that. Okay. The second thing I've got is at 51 seconds. So I've put change a little earlier as he walks out. So again, this is kind of, it's always a little bit malleable, these kind of timings, and exactly where you place something is going to be a function of, you know, not only your kind of creative choices about how you want to lead the viewer, and, you know, we have to be pragmatic about our bars and beats and not having violent tempo changes where, you know, they feel uncomfortable and all that kind of stuff. But I would try and find a way there of making that change slightly earlier. That would be my call. It just felt like that would be a more natural and more natural thing. The final thought that I had was, I think that when we get to 1:03, which I'm pretty sure is where we're kind of hitting the boudoir, you've got a kind of two things. I think it's like a kind of flute line, and you've got a cymbal happening at the same point as the very beginning of a line of dialogue. So again, I would say maybe it's only the cymbal, maybe, but I was always kind of taught by my mentors to avoid introducing a melody or a new instrument or anything like that at the same time as dialogue is happening, that you always try and creep around it. And so if you do have a bar line there and it's the start of a bar, it's the start of a new passage, then you just need to thin everything right out so that you, and then once the dialogue's established, then you can start bringing stuff in, because you're trying to make sure that you're not distracting the viewer's ear at the same time as the dialogue starts. You can kind of get away with things once it's underway, people are focusing on that line of dialogue, and then you're okay. Then you can come in underneath. But if you hit this exactly the same moment, you're going to risk pulling them away from, they'll be like, oh, what was that? What did they say? Or, you know, it's that kind of thing that we're trying to avoid all the time. So that's my notes on there. So Riwal, I would like you to tell us how you approached the score.
Yeah, so I tried to match the tone of the show by giving like a modern approach to it, with like electronic elements and non-electronic, so acoustic ones. And I like the idea of having a common thread throughout, like having one theme for the entire sequence. And yeah, trying to connect the dots between all the characters.
You are getting what you always wanted. You are marrying for love.
One may say modesty is a virtue, yet this author is hardly a virtuous woman. It is therefore my great pleasure to announce the news others questioned, but I never doubted.
It will be the grandest wedding of the year. Tulips are enough to fill the great room and the finest silks. Only the best. For Miss Bridgerton and my nephew. The latest whistledown. How does she report my triumph?
The diamond of the season has made her match. Officially betrothed to the Duke of Hastings.
Has something happened?
The bride undoubtedly is giddy with anticipation over the impending nuptials.
Well, I shall need fittings for the dress. And my trousseau. And, oh, I'm forgetting something, surely, Rose.
I shall take care of everything, miss. Just think, she'll be the Duchess by Saturday.
An event that will apparently take place sooner rather than later. Of course, there are only two reasons to procure a special license and race to the altar. True love, or concealing a scandal.
How does it feel, sister, to be in love?
Imagine leaping off a cliff and shattering on the ground. A fair analogy?
I'm afraid I cannot find the words, dear Hyacinth. Though, Eloise, I do believe you will know what love feels like soon enough next season.
Okay, so, fantastic. Now, what I would say is, it's a slightly different approach. It's a slightly different way of producing and doing this. So I would say that there is a slightly different way of looking at the production style. Now here, I would say my key thing, or the thing that I thought I would do if I was going to approach it in this way, is I would be as adventurous as possible with width, I might call it, and staging. So, what do I mean by that? I think I mean, the kind of classic thing that Trevor Horn has always mentioned is whiz bangs, or the things he calls whiz bangs. And if the classic example of that is, you know, in his early production stuff is, of course, Yes, you know, Owner of a Lonely Heart, where you've got really extreme things happening left and right. And while now you might listen to that and think, okay, that does sound back like very, very of that moment and that era, I think we can take those ideas and we can use them in the way that we approach production now. And so for this kind of approach, I would say really, you've got the opportunity. We're always trying to do this anyway, to keep out of the way of the center because of the dialogue, as usual. But I would say really go for it and really try and be extreme with the effects that you're using and the way that you're treating the instruments. And I mean the orchestral instruments as well. Really kind of push the boat out and allow yourself to get to the point where you think, oh, I've gone too far now and I have to start pulling it back in. That's always a great place to start. Whenever you're writing stuff, in my opinion, go to the extreme and then start to pull it back, because you'll end up with something that's a bit more adventurous. So that would be my technical tip. So in the creative side, the first point that I had was when we get to the start of the whistledown sequence, the pamphlet, at about 40 seconds, for my taste, I think you give the game away a little bit too early. So I would say, and it's only a few seconds, but I think you can just leave us hanging so that we don't quite know what the outcome is going to be. One of the things that I'm constantly having to remind myself when I'm writing to picture is, because I've watched it so many times and I know what's coming, I have to make sure that I'm not writing from my perspective, that I'm writing from the audience viewer perspective when they're watching it for the first time. And it's a real, one of the real danger points is giving the game away too early, because you know what's coming and you want to lead into it. That's the natural musical inclination. So that would be the first one. The second one is in that section where we have the reading. I would drop out the bass drum for that point, because I think that I love the way that that you get this slight slowdown. But for me, it needs to be slightly smoother. And the problem with the bass drum doing that as well is that it's drawing attention to itself. So in a moment where you've got a lot of complex dialogue going on, and we're conveying the idea of something's gone wrong, at that point you just want to sit underneath and make sure that you're not doing anything that's going to call attention to itself is probably the way that I would say. And I think that is slightly so That would be that section. And then the third thing is on the timings. And so when we cut to the boudoir, and I keep calling it a boudoir, it kind of looks like a boudoir to me. And also when we cut to the external carriage shot outside that exterior. Again, as these are kind of deliberate, very dramatic moves in terms of the visual production, I would absolutely hit those right on the nose. So I would make sure that your timings are leading you to have your new musical statements, bar lines, whatever, exactly on those cuts rather than kind of roundabout. So that would be my third point, is really go for it on those cuts. Make sure that you're hitting them right on. And actually, just to follow that up, right on doesn't necessarily mean that the bar line is exactly on the frame number of the cut. It means it might be a frame ahead, it might be a frame behind. And that's going to depend on the style of the music, but you want the effect to the viewer to be that they're happening absolutely bang on the same moment.
Yeah.
So there we go. Okay, let's move on to Chris. Thanks, Riwal. Let's move on to Chris. So, Chris, why don't tell us about how you approached scoring the picture.
I had never heard of Bridgerton before, so... But even from this minute and 45 second clip, you can learn who the characters are, which was helpful in the music for sure. But I wanted there to be a consistent pace throughout the whole piece. I wanted it to feel like one piece of music. And I wanted there to be a recognizable theme as well throughout the piece, and each section have its own mood as it, you know, it transitioned, which was difficult and really challenging, but yeah.
Okay, great. Let's have a look at your cue, and then we'll come back in and I'll have some thoughts.
You are getting what you always wanted. You are marrying for love.
May say modesty is a virtue, yet this author is hardly a virtuous woman. It is therefore my great pleasure to announce the news others questioned, but I never doubted.
It will be the grandest wedding of the year. Tulips are enough to fill the great room and the finest silks. Only the best for Miss Bridgerton and my nephew. The latest whistledown. How does she report my triumph?
The diamond of the season has made her match. Officially betrothed to the Duke of Hastings.
Has something happened?
The bride undoubtedly is giddy with anticipation over the impending nuptials.
Well, I shall need fittings for the dress. And my trousseau. And, oh, I'm forgetting something, surely, Rose.
I shall take care of everything, miss. Just think, you should be the Duchess by Saturday.
An event that will apparently take place sooner rather than later. Of course, there are only two reasons to procure a special license and race to the altar. True love, or concealing a scandal.
Does it feel, sister, to be in love?
Imagine leaping off a cliff and shattering on the ground. A fair analogy?
I'm afraid I cannot find the words, dear Hyacinth. Though, Eloise, I do believe you will know what love feels like soon enough next season.
Okay, so, Chris. So, my technical thought. Fantastic mix, orchestration is all working really, really well. I would say there are two things that I'd look at here. I would say... explore the dynamic range more. I know we've touched on this with a couple of the other tracks as well. Here, I would say maybe in your orchestration, as opposed to simply the moves on the controllers. So I would think about the kind of light and shade of maybe cutting sections and then bringing them in and that kind of thing. It's always, I quite often over orchestrate and then cut things out. It's easy, especially if you have a template where you've got all the instruments lined up. You kind of want to give everyone something to do. That's my natural instinct in the first place. And then I see what can I take out and still have the musical intent be as I wanted it, to get more kind of light and shade, if you like. And then the second thing that I thought, in the same kind of vein is about reverb. Now, I'm a terrible one for putting loads and loads of reverb on everything, because it kind of helps you write. I think it makes everything seem a bit more exciting and epic when you're writing. I do then sometimes, some of my friends would say not enough, try and take as much of the reverb off again as I can at the end, unless you're using something like a massive effect, like a, you know, you've got a kind of flute and you want it to sound like, you know, it's in a kind of super hall. Then I would say try and get back to as close as you can to the kind of acoustic sound of the orchestra. Maybe it's shortening the tails of the reverbs that you're using a little bit. Just altering the wet-dry balance again back in favour of the dry signal. And I don't think that this is... I don't think this is always a thing, but I think that for this particular picture, there is a kind of visual oral expectation of us hearing something that sounds like chamber music, however modern or stylized it is. If we then go into a kind of big epic production style, there's a slight mismatch for me. So that would be my technical advice. So in terms of the kind of creative ideas, things to think about, at 39 seconds, this sequence is great, but are we giving the game away? So I don't think it's the notes that you're using. I think that it's maybe the sounds that you're using in this case. So it might even be as simple as changing that high trem string back into a single, you know, continuous long note, or picking a different instrument. I think you can have tension without implying that something bad is going to happen. We're always kind of talking about the same kind of things when we're looking at music and analyzing music to picture. Right. And it almost always comes down to how are you telling the story, and right, what are we doing in support of the story and in support of the way that the director wants to tell the story. So so that's my first thought. Around 57 seconds, I always hate to say lose something, but I've put lose the harp lead in. My thought around that is that I think that you get more drama without having the lead in and just going straight in. It's often nice to have an instrument leading us into a transition or leading us into a new change, but just on this occasion, I think that, you know, just go straight in, leave the gap, and then bang, off we go again. Boudoir scene, great melodic lines. I think that this is a tricky one to work out what you would have done alternately, because they all work together really nicely. But I would say there's too many melodic lines happening at the same time. And the only reason for that, not because it's musically too many, but because dramatically, for us hearing the dialogue, understanding what they're saying, lots of things coming and going is going to distract the audience's ear away from the dialogue. So I would find a way. I think you've got the flutes, or flute, oboe, cellos, I think it is as well, and then the harp is kind of interjecting as well. I don't know what, maybe, you know, it could be just as simple as just saying lose the flute or lose the oboe, but just experiment with things that allow you to get more of the dialogue through. And again, it's that kind of golden rule of trying to avoid hitting the beginning of any piece of dialogue, even if we're into a scene, with a musical instrument enter. Or, you know, we always try and avoid that and write around and just try and make sure that we're not stepping on the toes of the dialogue. So those would be my kind of creative ideas for that. I have to say, for me, these were all really, really close. And I think that the quality of the runners-up of you guys here, it's really, really fantastic. I think they're really super high quality. And it wouldn't surprise me, you know, none of these entries would surprise me had I seen them actually playing behind the footage, you know, in the show. I think they're great, different ways of approaching the same scene. And this is the beauty of, you know, of a kind of job as a composer for media. So I just want to say fantastic. Well done to all of you. Really, really wonderful achievement, being runners up here, and, you know, great music. Thank you very much for entering.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks.
Thanks again to all of this year's runners-up. You can find hundreds of hours of inspirational and educational video content at the Spitfire Audio Academy website. Thanks very much for watching. See you on the next one. Bye-bye.